chapter 2. This is chapter 1, chapter 2, distribution theory. Chapter 3, subvariant spaces. And chapter 4, elliptic linear PD. If you want, you can take the note, or you can also wait. Maybe you will get at the end of this course from Patricia. You will get my full note from Patricia. The file is available, so you can get it after this lecture. So we start by some definition. And so we take let omega be an open set of Rn, and let P between 1 and plus infinity be defined Np of omega to be the set of measurable function f from omega to R such that the integral over omega f p dx is finite. And we define L infinity of omega as a set of measurable function f from omega to R such that the essential sum of f is finite, where the essential sum of f is the infinimum of k positive, such that absolute value of f of x is less or equal to k almost everywhere. So it means L infinity is a set of bounded function almost everywhere. F is bounded almost everywhere. It means there is k such that f of x is less than some k almost everywhere. And Np is a set of functions such that f power p is in L1 is integrable. And if we have two functions, we say that f is equivalent to g if and only if f is equal to g almost everywhere on omega. So we can define an equivalent relation between two functions as following: f is equivalent to g if f is equal to g almost everywhere. And so we can take now let Lp of omega. This Lp is a set of function, and in Lp we define this equivalent relation, and we define Lp to be the set of class for this equivalent relation. So let Lp be the class with aspect to this relation. So if F is in LB, we look F has an equivalent class. But in general, we look F also has a function. And if we say F is in LB of omega, F, for example, continues. This we give a meaning to this, because if we say F is in LP and F is a continuous function, it means that in this class we find a continuous function. This means there exists G such that G is continuous and G is equal to F almost everywhere. This is the meaning of a function in this space is continuous. It means that there exists a function g which is equal to f almost everywhere, and this function g is continuous. Because this is an equivalent class, so if we say this, it means we look f has a function. But saying that f is continuous means there exists a function g equivalent to f such that this function g is continuous. And from this space now, we will define a norm in this space. The norm we will define in this space, you will see that it is not necessarily a norm if you look at in this space. So, if we take for one, if P is between 1 and plus infinity, we define this quantity P is the integral over omega absolute value of P 1 over P. This is for P between 1 and plus infinity. And for P equal plus infinity, we define this quantity to be the essential sub of F. And we have the following result, theorem. Let P between 1 and plus infinity. Then we have LP of omega with this quantity is a normal linear space. Is a normal linear space. It means that first we have to show that this is a vector space, and this defines a norm in this vector space. So this defines now a norm linear space. And to prove the fact that this is a linear space, we essentially use the Minkowski inequality. We use it to prove that if we have two functions in LP, the sum remains in LP. And we use the same inequality also to show that triangular inequality is true for this quantity. This I think you have seen in real analysis. The fact that this is a vector space and this is a norm. So we assume this and we go to the main property of LP spaces. So the first property is this theorem. So we have LP of omega with this norm P is a Banach space. Is a Banach space for one, for P between 1 and plus infinity is separable for 1 P plus infinity. L infinity is not separable and is reflexive for one, for P between 1 and plus infinity strictly. So this is the main property we have in LP space. LP space is Banach for all P between 1 and plus infinity, is separable for P strictly less than plus infinity, N is reflexive for P between 1 and plus infinity strictly. If you have any question, you can stop me. Huh? You don't need to wait the end. You can stop at any time.
Huh? Could you remind me of the definition of separable?
Separable means LP has a dense and a countable dense subset. This is the meaning of separable. LP has a countable dense subset. L infinity is not separable. And for reflexive, we have LP is reflexive for all P between 1 and plus infinity. L infinity is not reflexive. L1 also is not reflexive. Let us prove that LP is Banach. So we prove. We take let Fn be the Cauchy sequence in LP. I first prove for P between 1 and plus infinity, and we prove separately. We prove LP is Banach for P strictly less than plus infinity, and LP is Banach for P equal plus infinity. So let us take a Cauchy sequence. So, fact one, we have there exists f and k, a subsequence of fn such that norm of fn k plus 1 minus fn k is p is strictly less than 1 over. If you have a Cauchy sequence, we can always find a subsequence which satisfies this property. How to get it? How to construct a subsequence satisfying this? We can construct term by term of this subsequence, because for this to be a subsequence, we need Nk to be an increasing sequence. So if we take for k equal 1, so I can take epsilon to be 1 over 2 over 1, and for this epsilon I can write the fact that Fn is Cauchy. So it means what? There exists N1 belong to capital L such that for P and Q greater than N1, we have what? Norm of Fp minus Fq is strictly less than 1 over this. This is just the definition of Cauchy sequence by taking epsilon to be this. For any epsilon, there exists N. So for this epsilon, there exists N1. Such that for all P and Q greater than N1, this inequality is true. Okay? And now we can take let K, for example, to be 2, and we take epsilon to be 1 over 2 squared. For this epsilon, there exists first N2 in capital N, such that for P, Q greater than N2, we have norm of Fp minus Fq is strictly less than 1 over 2 squared. And here I don't take directly there exists N2, because if I take N2, I don't know if N2 is greater than N1 or not. But from here, I can construct N2 which is greater than N1, such that Fn2 minus Fn1 is less than 1 over 2. How to get this? So we take let N2 to be the maximum between N1 plus 1 and N2. This N2, I get it by taking K to be 2. So this N1, I get it by taking K to be 1. So I define now N2 to be the maximum between this N1 plus 1 and this N2. So that we have is N2 is greater than N1. Because N2 is the maximum between N1 plus 1. And so here in this relation, I can take P to be N2 and I can take Q to be N1. So we will have P and Q is greater than N1, because if I take P to be N2, I know that N2 is greater than N1. So that we have is Fn2 minus Fn1 is strictly less than 1 over 1 because of this. Because I construct N2 to be the maximum. So this N2 is greater than N1. And if I take Q to be N1, so I have both P and Q greater than N1. And so Fp minus Fq is less than this. So I get this first step. And so on. The next step is how to construct N3. How to construct N3. To get N3, so we take K to be 3. If I take K to be 3, I take epsilon to be 1 over 2 power 3. For this epsilon, I write the fact that Fn is Cauchy. So there exists N3, such that for P and Q greater than N3, we have norm of Fp minus Fq is strictly less than 1 over Q. And now let us take N3 to be what? How to define N3? To be the maximum between N2 plus 1 and N2. And N3. This N3, yeah? And N3. And I back here by taking P to be N3, so P will be greater than N2, and by taking Q to be N2, and so I will have Fn3 minus Fn2, P and Q satisfy this condition, so this is strictly less than 1 over 2 squared, and so on. If you construct Nk, now you know how to get Nk plus 1. And this we can do for all k. So we can construct a subsequent Fnk such that norm of Fnk plus 1 minus Fnk is less than. So subsequent exists Fnk. This is strictly less than 1 over 2k. So for any Cauchy sequence, we can construct a subsequent which satisfies this. This is the first thing, and we get it. Now, what we want is, we take a Cauchy sequence here, and we want to show that this Cauchy sequence converges to a function in LP. But since we have a Cauchy sequence, we have a subsequence. If we can show that this subsequence converges, then the Cauchy sequence converges. Because if a Cauchy sequence has a convergent subsequence, then it converges. So we need only now to prove that Fnk converges in LP. If Fnk converges in LP, since Fn is a Cauchy sequence, then Fn also will converge. This is true for Cauchy sequence. But in general, for arbitrary sequence, it is not true. Because if we take this sequence Xn to be minus 1 over n, if I take x to n, this sequence subsequence converges to 1. But this sequence does not converge because this sequence is not is not Cauchy. So if a Cauchy sequence has a convergent subsequence, then it converges. This is what we will use to prove that LP is valid. We need only now to prove that this subsequence converges. So let us now work with this subsequence. For k greater than 1, we define gk to be the sum for I equal 1 to k absolute value of fni plus 1 minus fni. I define gk to be this. This is the absolute value. Here, first thing we have is gk belong to LP of omega. Because LP is a vector space. And absolute value, each fni is in LP. So this difference is a function in LP. The absolute value remains in LP. And here I have a finite sum. So this finite sum remains in LP. So for any k, gk belong to LP of omega. And two, let us see norm of gk in LP. So by using triangular inequality, because I have gk is the sum of this, so the norm of gk is less than sum for a equal 1 to k of norm of fni plus 1 minus fni. It not. So I know that each term here is less than sum for I equal 1 to k. Fni plus 1 minus fni is less than 1 over 2i. 1 over 2i. And this is strictly less than what? This we can compute. Huh? This summation is less than is less than 1. This is less than 1. So here you have 3. We have gk is an increasing sequence. Because gk plus 1 is gk plus the last term. So gk is an increasing sequence. And so we can use the monotone convergence theorem. So by using the monotone convergence theorem, there exists a function g in LP of omega such that gk converges to g. Gk converges to g in converges to g almost everywhere. And we have gk, if you want, we have gk converges to g almost everywhere. And we use this sequence now, gk, first to show that fnk converges pointwise to some function f. And this function f is in LP, and fnk converges to f in LP. So we need first to find the limit candidate of this sequence fnk. So first we have this. We have to show fnk converges pointwise to sum f in lp of omega. We have to show first that fnk converges pointwise to sum function f in lp. And after that, we show that fnk converges to f in lp. And so this prove the fact that FNK converts to FN in LP. Now, to show that FNK converts pointwise, so we have to show that FNK of X converts to some function f of x almost everywhere x in omega. So we use the fact that dk converts to g almost everywhere. So it means there exists a set of measure 0 such that outside this set, dk converts to g pointwise. So we take let x in omega, capital N, where N is the set of X in omega such that we take N, this is the set of X in omega. So what I want to say is N is the set such that outside N we have convergence of GK to G, and where N is such that for all x in omega, N dk of x converts to g of x, because gk converts to g almost everywhere. So there exists N, a set of measure 0, such that outside N we have this pointwise convergence. And here we have the measure of N is equal to 0. So if I take x now outside this set, if I take x outside n, we have to show that fnk of x is Cauchy in R. And if you can show that fnk of x is Cauchy in R, then fnk of x will convert to some point in R. To do this, let us compute fnl of x minus fn h of x. I take, because I want to show that this is Cauchy, so I have to show that this converts to 0 when l and h goes to plus infinity. So from this, I can use the definition, I can write this as, this is fn l of x minus f n l minus 1 of x plus f n h plus 1 of x minus f n h of x. Here I assume that n is greater than h. So I write this difference like this. But if you see this term, I can write it as, this is nothing else than, I can write this by using g. Because if you see, gh of x is what? What is gh? Gh of x is just the summation for I equal 1 to h of fni plus 1 of x minus fni of x. Now if you take gh minus gl, you get exactly this term. So this is nothing else than this term from here to here. This is gh of x minus gl of x. And this term is positive because g is an increasing sequence and h is greater than l. Now, if you let l and h go to 0, this term will go to 0 because gk converts to g almost everywhere. So, this term converts to g, this term also converts to z. So, this term will go to 0 as h goes to plus infinity and l goes to plus infinity. So this implies that fnk of x is Cauchy in R. because for each x, this is the Cauchy sequence, this is the real number. So this sequence now is Cauchy enough. And from there, we use the fact that R is complete. So there exists f of x such that f and k of x converge to f of x.
Excuse me.
Yes?
The fact that we are working in LP and then we think of LP like the set of equivalent class.
Mm-hmm.
So why, when you take the convergence of GK, converges to D almost equal in this case now?
Because why you?
Why the convergence is also almost everywhere?
Because we identify a class, a function. If you take F as NP, so if you see how to define the norm of F, we define the norm. The norm of F is what? We define the norm to be the integral over omega F over P, 1 over P. And you take F in NP. So you take F as a class. But if you write this, it means that you identify the function f has its class. It means that this is the same to write this where f, even here you take g, where g is any element from this class f. So this quantity remains the same. But we don't need, if we take f, we take f has the class. So we identify this function f has its class. So it is the same. If you take f, a function in LP, f can be seen as a class. But f also can be seen as a function. If you look f as a function, it means that you take any function in the class of f, any function which is equivalent to f. So if now here I look any f and k has a class, but I take f and k has a function because this class is defined by some function, g and k if you want. But I keep the same notation. F and k here can be seen as a function and it can be seen also as a class. If I take f and k of x, it means that f and k is look has a function. If you take norm of f and k, it means that f and k can be seen as a class. So this is just identification. If you take any function in LP, this function f can be seen as a function also in the class of fn. Okay? So any function, if you write f is LP of omega, so this means you can look f has a class. But if you want also, you can look f has a function. But where? Has a function in the class of f. So if f is in LP, you take g equivalent to f almost everywhere. So it means that g and f are equivalent. If you want to compute the norm of f, it's the same as if you compute the norm of g. Because if g is equal to f almost everywhere, this means g is equal to f. But this equality is true in LP of omega. This equality is true as function. And this equality is true as class. Because these two functions are equivalent. So the class of f is the same as the class of g. Okay? So we make identification. If I take f in LP, so this function f, I can look f as a class, but I can look f also as a function, but a function in the class of f. You can replace this function f by any function g, such that g is equivalent to f. Okay? So, we have seen that for any x, f and k of x, this is a Cauchy sequence in R. So f and k of x converge in R to some real number I call f of x. And so we can define this function now. So we define So we define let f from omega to r, defined by f of x by definition to be the limit when k goes to plus infinity, f and k of x. And this is defined for all x in omega minus n. Because if x is in omega minus n, we can do the same work because gk of x converges. Because we have the convergence of gk almost everywhere. And so we define n such that if x is outside omega minus n, gk of x converges. So I define this function f only in this term. Because if you take x in n, I don't know if f is well defined or not. But I'm sure that f of x is defined for all x in omega minus n. But since the measure of n is equal to 0, so this function f is defined almost everywhere. Since the measure of n is 0, then f is defined almost everywhere on omega, because f is defined except in n, which is a set of measure 0. So f is defined almost everywhere. Now, let us show that f is in NP, this function f. So if we back here from this inequality, we have absolute value of f l minus f n h of x. We know that this is less than g h of x minus g l of x. Okay, so this term is less than g h of x because I drop a positive term. And so I can let l goes to plus infinity. I can let l goes to plus infinity. If l goes to plus infinity, I know that fnk of x converges to f of x. So if l goes to plus infinity, so this term becomes f of x minus fnh of x is less or equal to gh of x. Okay, and this is true almost everywhere because it's true only where f is defined. Now, from this inequality, we know that gh of x is in Lp. So it means that this difference is in Lp. But since this function is in Lp, so this implies that this function is in Lp. So if we see, so this implies from this inequality that f minus fn h, this belongs to Lp of omega because this function is bounded by the Lp function. So this difference is in Lp. But since f and h belong to Lp, we have f also is in Lp of omega, because we can write f to be f minus fnh plus fnh. This term is in Lp, this function is in Lp, Lp is a vector space, so this summation, which is f, belongs also to Lp. So our limit function is now in Lp. And so it remains only to show that fnk converges to f now in Lp, because here we have only pointwise convergence. Now we have to show that fnk converges to f in Lp. And we can get it from here, because if you see, we have absolute value of f of x minus fnh of x is less or equal to gh of x. But since gk is an increasing sequence, so gk is less than g of x, because the limit of gk is the sum. So this is less than g of x. And since now f and k converge to f, so this difference converges to zero. And this difference is less than by the NP function. So by dominant convergence theorem, this function converges to this in NP. So by dominant convergence theorem, we have f and k converge to f in NP of f. Because if you want, you take first OP and you take OP here. And now this becomes a function in L1. This is a function in L1. But this difference converges to zero. And this is bounded by a L1 function. So it means that the integral of this will converge to zero. But if the integral of this converges to zero, the integral of this gives you exactly the norm of f minus f and h in LP. So you have directly this one. And if you see now from the proof, we have a consequence of the proof, and this consequence is useful if you are working in LP space. So if you have, if Fn converges to F in LP of omega, then we don't have necessarily the pointwise convergence. The convergence in LP does not imply pointwise convergence. But that we have is, if Fn converges to F in LP, then there exists a subsequence of Fn which converges pointwise to F. So if Fn converges to F in LP, then there exists Fnk, a subsequence of Fn such that Fnk of x converges to f of x almost everywhere x is omega. You don't have Fn of x converge to f of x. This is not true. Convergence is in norm does not imply pointwise convergence. But this implication is true up to a subsequence. If Fn converges to f in norm in LP, then Fn has a subsequence Fnk such that Fnk of x converges to f of x almost everywhere. Because sometimes people use it, they use, we have Fn converges to f, and we want to know what happens for the pointwise convergence. The pointwise convergence is not true in general. But up to a subsequence now, the pointwise convergence is true. If Fn converges to F in LP, then we can find a subsequence such that we have pointwise convergence. And this result comes from the proof. It is not a corollary of the fact that LP is Banach. No, this is the consequence of the proof. Because if you take Fn converges to F in LP, so Fn is a Cauchy sequence because it converges. And so you can use the same proof, because since Fn is Cauchy, so I copy the same proof, so I construct this sequence Fnk such that Fnk plus 1 minus Fnk is less than 1 over 2k. I copy, use the same argument, and from the proof I know that this function f converges to some function ft by copying the proof. And almost everywhere. And after we have seen that Fnk will converge to ft in norm. But we have Fn converge to f in norm. So it means what? It means that f tilde is equal to f. And so you have Fn converges to f pointwise. So all that we have is, if Fn converges to f in norm, then there exists a subsequence FNK such that FNK converts to F almost everywhere. And this is the consequence of the proof. Okay? And now you can try to do in exercise the fact that so homework one. For homework, so L infinity of omega is balanced. To prove this hint, you will use the fact that the norm of F infinity, you will use the fact that F of x is less or equal to the norm of F infinity almost everywhere. This is true for all x almost everywhere. Absolute value of F of x is less or equal to norm of F infinity. Because if you go back to the definition of this norm, because this norm is the essential sup of f. If you go back to this definition, you will see that you can get absolute value of f of x is less than norm of f in infinity. And from there, you can prove that L infinity is bad. Take arbitrary Cauchy sequence, write the fact that your sequence is Cauchy, and for all x, write the fact that fn of x is Cauchy in R, and you use the same argument and you get the fact that L infinity is a Banach space. So this is the first exercise. This is one. Two. Assume that omega is bounded, or assume that the module of omega is finite. We can drop this. We just assume that the module of omega is bounded. Because this one is stronger than bounded. The module of omega is finite, is weaker than bounded. Because if omega is bounded, then the module of omega is finite. But the converse is not true. If the module of omega is finite, this does not imply that omega is bounded. If you take Q, you take any countable set in R, the module is zero, but the set is not necessarily bounded. So here we assume that the module of omega is finite. Show that if P is less than Q, then greater than 1, then LQ of omega is inside LP of omega. If P is less than Q, then LQ is inside LP. If you see now, for LP, small LP, set of sequence, that we have is, if P is less than Q, LP also is smaller than LQ. We have the same direction. If P is smaller, then LP is smaller. But for big LP, that we have is, if P is smaller, then LQ is smaller than LP. So this is that we have to prove. And to show that if so if omega is bounded, which space is the smaller one? for all L infinity. The smaller one is L infinity. Is L infinity. Shows that if F belongs to L infinity of omega, then the limit when P goes to plus infinity of norm of Fp, this gives exactly norm of F infinity. This makes sense because if I take F in L infinity, so for any P, because since the measure of omega is finite, we have L infinity is inside Lp for any P greater than 1. So if I take F in L infinity, so F belongs to Lp for any P. So for any P, I can compute this type. And if I let P go to plus infinity, that we get is exactly the norm of F in infinity. Okay? So this now, if omega is not bounded, this has no meaning. Because if omega is not bounded, if I take F in L infinity, I don't know if F is in Lp or not. So I cannot compute norm of Fp for any P. But if we assume that omega is bounded, if we assume that the measure of omega is finite, if you take F in L infinity, so this makes sense for any P, because L infinity is inside Lp. And so for any P, we can compute norm of Fp. And we let P go to plus infinity, and we have to show that the limit of this is exactly the norm of Fp infinity. And to prove it, you can use for both use order inequality. Use order inequality. What is order inequality? Order inequality says the following things. You have what? If we take let P between 1 and plus infinity, and we take let Q such that 1 over P plus 1 over Q is 1. Okay? That we have is if F belongs to Lp and G belongs to Lq, then we have the product Fg is where? Is in L1, and we have the integral over omega Fg dx. This is less or equal to what? Norm of F in Lp, 1 over P times norm of G, or write directly, this is less than norm of Fp times norm of G Q. This is order inequality. Okay? So now the general order inequality is we take let P1 to Pk greater than 1. And let R greater than 1 such that 1 over R is 1 over P1, 1 over Pk. That we have now, if Fi is in Lpk, Pi, then this product function F, which is F1, F2 to Fk, this product function belongs to Lr. And norm of F in Lr is less or equal to the product of norm of Fi in Lpi. Okay? So if you see, if I take K to be 2, so I have P1 and P2. And I assume that 1 over P1 plus 1 over P2 is 1. So it means that 1 over R is 1. So it means that R is equal to 1. So we get exactly all this inequality. Okay? So it means now if you have F in NP and G in LQ, I want to know where is FG. So to know where is FG, I just compute 1 over P plus 1 over Q. And I try to get this is, for example, 1 over R. If 1 over P plus 1 over Q is 1 over R, so this product is in LR. For example, if I take F in L3 and G in L7, for example. So let us see what is 1 over 3 plus 1 over 7. I compute 1 over P plus 1 over Q. So I get this is what? This is 1 over 21. So it means that our R here,
over 10.
Okay, is 10 over 21. And this, I want this to be 1 over R. For this to be 1 over R, it means that R is equal to what? 21 over 10. So if F is in L3 and G is in L7, then the product is where? Is in L21 over 20. So this is the way we use the general Holder's inequality. Now is useful. So you can try to do as exercise. It's not difficult because to prove it, you will use exactly Holder's inequality. You use Holder's inequality to get this one. The last inequality also you can have is if you have F is in LP intersect LQ of omega. Omega is not bounded, or the measure of omega also is not necessarily finite. Because if the measure of omega is finite, I know that either LP is in LQ or LQ is in LP. And so this intersection is LP or LQ. So this is for arbitrary omega. F is in the intersection and LP and LQ. Omega is arbitrary. Proof that where is if F is in LP intersect LQ, prove that F belongs to LR for all R between P and Q. So this is just notation because I don't know if P is greater than Q or not. So all that we have is if F is in the intersection, then F is in LR for all R between P and Q. So it means that if F is in L2 and G, if F is in L2 intersect L7, then F is in LR for R between 2 and 7. So this is the main of this. And we have more, F is here. And since R is in between P and Q, so it means that we can write 1 over R to be alpha over P plus 1 minus alpha over Q. Why? Because if R is here, so 1 over R